It was nearly 9 o'clock. Welcome to Tuesday the 16th of July. This is week three, part two. We're going to continue today with our matrix, more at the phenomenological and cross-section fitting end of things. But that's for Pierre and for Ed today. I just want to ask you, I've got a rough list here, projects and titles. You had some working titles earlier on in the week, which you scribbled on a piece of paper, and these have been translated into something resembling English language, with some interpretation of exactly what you meant. So perhaps if I leave this out on the back table here, at coffee time you can just go and have a look, and if you think it's incorrect, maybe just scribble on it. I'll leave a couple of copies, okay? And very few gaps. Let's say there's a little bit of interpretation going. Your ideas may have changed by talking to people in the meantime. So just so that we have a running tally of where we are, perhaps you can just have a look at your entry and update it. Or if it's right, you may just want to put a tick alongside, and then we won't need to bother you again on this particular front. Okay. All right, so Pierre's going to start today. It's going to be an interestingly ordered day, I think. So this Pierre's going to look after you till coffee, and then it'll be more fluid. And then Ed will take over for a bit. Okay. Yeah. Enjoy.
Okay, thanks. So today I'm going to talk about the other variants of the R matrix. Yesterday I've shown you the origin of the R matrix and the application to the calculable R matrix with the goal of solving the Schrödinger equation. And today what you are going to do is to use the R matrix in a slightly different way, which is to fit data. But I'm going to show you that the origin of the phenomenological R matrix is exactly the same and can be explained exactly as from the calculable R matrix. So I'm going to start with a short introduction and then show you how to derive this phenomenological R matrix, which may be the one you are used to see in books or papers. And then I will have to discuss one of the problems of the R matrix that Ed already mentioned yesterday, is that the R matrix parameters that you use in the R matrix formula and which are called calculated parameters are related to resonance properties, widths and energies, but they are not exactly the resonance and widths that you get from experiment and from the other model. So these observed parameters correspond to experiment or from what you get from other calculation. So it's very important to make a link between the R matrix parameter, which are the calculated parameter, and the experimental data, which are called observed parameters. Then I will show you applications of the phenomenological R matrix. And as I did yesterday, I will start with applications as simple as possible, so with spin zero, elastic scattering. And then I will briefly mention how to extend that the phenomenological R matrix to other processes like inelastic scattering or transfer and even to capture reactions. Okay, so this is a kind of summary of what I've shown yesterday. This is a typical situation from an experimental point of view. So you have here a cross-section. This is an elastic cross-section neon 18 plus P. So you have this data. The question that you ask yourself is, what kind of information can I extract from this data? What are the resonances, energies, what are the spin, their widths, and so on. So this is something that the R matrix can do for you, the phenomenological R matrix. In nuclear astrophysics, there are also many applications of the phenomenological R matrix. I don't want to enter into detail, just want to show you a typical example, which is C12 alpha gamma. You have data points here, which are very scattered because The Amani experiment, it's a quite difficult experiment. And what you would like to do is to derive the S factor in this region here. And as you can see, we are far from the experimental range. And so this is one of the problems of the air matrix. So this kind of applications can be easily done with the phenomenological air matrix. So how to use when you want to fit data, what you have from experiment, generally you have cross sections. In very few cases you have phase shift, but in general what you may hope to have is the cross section. In particular for radioactive beams when the intensity is low, so you cannot hope to have a phase shift analysis. And, well, in a theory, of course, if you want to compare, you have to compute the same thing. So you have to compute the cross-section. And as you have seen several times, the cross-section is obtained from the scattering matrices, U. And these matrices, U, are obtained from the air matrix. So if you know the air matrices for each L value, then you can derive the cross-section and compare to experiments. And as we will see today, we can express the air matrix as a sum over poles. This is the usual expression of the air matrix. And I will show you in a moment that it's completely equivalent to what we have seen yesterday. So you can express the air matrix as a sum over different poles. So the poles are referred to as lambda. And there is an inner G E lambda and the reduced with gamma lambda square. And in the phenomenological air matrix, these numbers, gamma lambda square and E lambda, are considered as free parameters. So you fit these parameters here, and then you can compute the air matrix, then the scattering matrix, and then finally the cross section. Okay, so this is the procedure to use the phenomenological air matrix. So the question we would like to address is, how does it come from? We have seen yesterday another definition of the air matrix, starting from basis functions. So we would like to know where does this come from, and what is the link with the calculable air matrix. Another question, as I mentioned in my introduction, is the link between the air matrix parameters and the experimental data. You have here the pole energies, for example, E lambda. So a question is, do these E lambda correspond to experimental resonance energies? And in fact, they don't. They are associated with these experimental energies, but there is a link between them. Okay, so let me start with the derivation of the phenomenological air matrix. This is a short summary of what I've shown yesterday for the general introduction to the air matrix. So you start from a channel radius, A, and we discuss the choice of this channel radius. It must be large enough to make sure that the nuclear interaction is negligible. And you have a set of n basis functions. And in the tutorial yesterday, we used Gaussian functions. You can use any Gaussian, any function that you like. And then, of course, we start from an Hamiltonian. And then you have a general definition of the air matrix, where, well, you have here a numerical factor, very simple. You have matrix D, and matrix D is nothing but the matrix element of the Hamiltonian and the block operator. And I remind you, this block operator is a surface operator. It's defined at the channel radius. So then you invert this matrix, and you take a double sum with the same basis functions evaluated at the channel radius A. And the constant L here is given by the logarithmic derivative of the Coulomb function O. Okay, and so when you have the air matrix, then you insert it in this expression, and then you get the scattering matrix. This is a simple formula for single channel scattering. So let me write again the definition here of the air matrix and of the D matrix. And here I didn't specify which basis functions I'm using. I can choose whatever I like. The important thing is that they are consistent. So you have here phi evaluated at the channel radius, and here you have a matrix element involving the same phi. So what is important is to be consistent, to use the same phi here and the same phi there. But otherwise, you are free to choose the basis function you like. So let's choose a particular type of wave functions, which are the eigenstates of this operator, H plus the block operator. So how do we know these eigenstates? This is another question. This is for the next slide. So imagine we know the eigenstates of this operator. So these eigenstates are defined by this equation. This is an eigenvalue equation. U lambda are the eigenfunctions, and E lambda are the eigenvalues. So then, if you use this basis function, and if you introduce them in the calculation of matrix D, now index instead of ij is lambda lambda prime, it's just double index, change nothing. So by definition of these eigenstates, you can see that U lambda at H L U lambda prime is nothing but the eigenvalue, E lambda. And, well, these eigenstates are orthogonal, so U lambda E is just a constant. U lambda prime is a delta function. So this matrix D is very simple. It's just a diagonal. And on the diagonal, there is only the eigenvalues and the energy. E is the scattering energy, so the energy of the collision, the one you are interested in. And one of the nice things is that this matrix, because it's diagonal and very simple, can be easily inverted analytically. It's just given by the inverse of each matrix element. And now, if you insert this definition of the D matrix in the R matrix here, you see that instead of a double sum, because of this delta lambda lambda prime, you have a single sum. So now the R matrix is a single sum, with sum over lambda here. Then you recognize the coefficient, which is here and comes from there. So you have the inverse of the D matrix E lambda minus E. And then you have the wave functions evaluated at a channel radius. So these are constant, these are just numbers. And then you end up with this expression where gamma lambda is called the reduced width, and which is always positive. There is a square here. And this gamma lambda, this reduced width is nothing but the wave function at the channel radius to the square and some coefficient. So you see that this standard expression of the R matrix can be completely equivalent to the original definition of the R matrix here. So these are two equivalent definitions. And these gamma lambda are real energy independent. They are called reduced widths. And because they are proportional to the wave function at the channel radius, they provide a kind of measurement of the clustering. So A should be large. 5, 6 Fermi, something like that. So if the wave function at this large radius is important, so it means that the probability to have the two particles far away is rather large. So it means that you have a cluster state. And when you have a nucleon plus system, the traditional terminology is single particle state. So this is a method with this gamma lambda. If you can evaluate this gamma lambda, you can have an idea of the structure of the state. And this is better done by using the dimensionless reduced width, which is nothing but the reduced width divided by the Wigner limit. So the Wigner limit is given by this constant, and it's easy to show that the reduced width cannot be larger than that. So the dimensionless reduced width is always lower than 1 and provides you with an approximation of the clustering in the nucleus. Okay, so here I assume that we know these eigenfunctions. So the next question is how to determine these eigenfunctions. Well, it's very simple. Let's start from the basis. We had the basis, which could be Gaussians, Lagrange functions, as we said yesterday. So we expand this basis function, these eigenstates over this basis. We compute the matrix element H and N, and we simply diagonalize this this problem. And then you get the E lambdas, which are the eigen energies, and they will be called the pole energies, so this E lambda here. And when from this diagonalization here, you also get a coefficient C, and C are nothing but the eigenvectors. With the C, so when you have coefficient C here, you can compute the eigenstates for any R value, and in particular for A, and then you derive this gamma lambda square. So in the tutorial of yesterday, there was a question at the end, which should have been after this lecture, but it was a little in advance, where you could compute the R matrix either without this change of basis or after this change of basis. So there is here just a diagonalization of the matrix element, but these are two completely equivalent methods. Okay, so the general definition of the R matrix is written here. And here you can see the different spirits of this variant in the calculable R matrix. So what you have been doing yesterday, these parameters here, gamma lambda square and E lambda, are computed from the basis functions. Okay. And in the phenomenological R matrix, these parameters are fitted to the data. So this is the same origin, but used in a different ways. And of course, in this calculable variant, you can use 10, 20, 30 basis functions as you like. It doesn't make the calculation difficult. But in practice, when you use a phenomenological R matrix, you will not use 20 poles, because it means that you would have 2 times 20, so it's 40 parameters. So when you use a phenomenological variant, you try to reduce as much as you can the number of parameters. And unless there are several resonances that you know that are important, the most frequent approximation is to use the single pole approximation. So just cutting this expansion to the first term and keeping only the one which is associated with a resonance. And of course, as I mentioned before, the main problem is the link between these parameters here, E lambda and gamma lambda square. So these pole energies are presented here as a black lines, and the physical parameters. So I present here in red these physical energies, which are the observed parameters. There is a shift here. So one of the problems is to make a link between this set of parameters, and I will show you in a moment how to do that. And let me take a simple example to make a link between the calculable R matrix and the phenomenological R matrix. This is the C12 plus proton system, which was considered yesterday for the tutorial. So the potential is a Gaussian. You can reproduce very well the phase shift with 10 basis functions. And if you compute the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian, then you get 10 basis functions, so 10 eigenvalues, 10 E lambda, and 10 values for gamma lambda. This 10 comes from the fact that you have here 10 basis functions. And if you plot the R matrix, so the exact R matrix, this is a sum over the pole of this expression, and you can see that this is function which is always increasing with energy. It never decreases because you have a square here. And if you compute the derivative, this is always positive. And the R matrix has discontinuities at the values of the pole energies. And I plot here the R matrix in a small energy range from 0 to 0.8. And you see that in this calculation, there is one pole at 0.11. And this is the discontinuity that you can see here. So this is a typical form of the R matrix. Okay, so now let's consider the different poles. So how would you use that in a phenomenological air matrix? Well, you see that there is one pole with an energy close to the resonance energy, which is about 0.4, and you see that the is reduced, which is large. So you expect this contribution to be important. And as you can see here, there are other poles, but because, if you are looking at low energies, these poles have a contribution like this, where E lambda is always much larger than E. If you are at low energies, all these E lambda are larger. So you may consider as a good approximation that this term does not depend on energy. And this term is called the background. And a good approximation is to assume that this background is about constant. So if you want to go beyond the single pole approximation, so the single pole approximation is just this term, you may introduce a background. And I will show you in a moment that in that case, the background is in general small. So these different contributions are plotted here. So I take the exact exact air matrix, which is plotted in black here, so you can see it here. So this black curve corresponds to the exact air matrix with all poles introduced. And the single pole approximation here is represented in yellow. And the background is represented in light blue here. So the sum of these two curves reproduces the black curve. And as you can see, the single pole approximation in that case, in that specific case, is a very good approximation. And you can see that R0 is constant, almost constant as we expected, and also very small compared to the resonant term. And in particular, if you are in the resonance region, this R0 is negligible. And assuming that R0 equals zero, or assuming that you keep a single term here, is equivalent to the Breit-Wigner approximation. So the Breit-Wigner approximation is a specific case of the with the air matrix, with a single pole air matrix. Okay, so there is an equivalence between both. And here I also like to remark that the air matrix is not limited to resonances. In fact, there are calculations where you have a pure non-resonant process, and then you can simulate this process with a constant air matrix. So the air matrix is not limited to resonances. It's usually used for resonances, but it could also describe non-resonant processes. So then let me come to the problem of the air matrix, which is this link between observed and calculated air matrix parameters. So you have fitted some air matrix parameters, and then you want to compare with experiments, or you want to compare with another calculation. Then you cannot do that, because they are not, strictly speaking, equal to the observed parameters. So you have to make a link between these air matrix parameters and the observed parameters. So this is easily done for a single pole approximation. And to do that, let me remind you the general definition of the scattering matrix. So for a single channel calculation, this is given by this expression that you can write with the phase shift. And the phase shift contains two terms, one which is associated with the Hartsphere phase shift, which is here, and another one which is associated with the air matrix phase shift, which is there. So you can easily obtain both contributions. This is the standard Hartsphere phase shift, and this is the air matrix phase shift. So this expression is easily obtained from here. So here I remind you that P is the penetration factor, S the shift factor, so you can get them from Coulomb subroutines, and R is the air matrix. Okay? And how to define a resonance energy, a physical resonance energy? Well, this is obtained when there is a discontinuity in this function here. So the resonance energy is defined by this equation, 1 minus shift function times R equal to 0. So this is, in general, an equation which doesn't have an analytical solution and should be solved numerically, because S may be a complicated function, R can be also a complicated function. So in general, you have to solve that numerically. But in the single pole approximation, it's quite easy, and I will show you in a moment. So this is again my my example with carbon 12 plus P. So you have here, this pink color is the Hartzsphere phase shift. It always goes to negative value. This yellow curve is the R matrix phase shift, and this is the total. And you see that there is here a resonance at 0.4 MeV. And if you remind, if you remember, the pole energy was about 0.1. So how can we recover the resonance energy? We have to solve this equation, and here we'll solve it numerically. So how can we do that? We plot the R matrix and 1 over S. And when both curves cross each other, then we have the solution. Okay, so this is a numerical procedure. The pole energy is here, 0.11. The R matrix is this black curve with a discontinuity. And 1 over S is this red curve. And you can see that these two curves cross each other around here, 0.42 MeV. Which corresponds to this jump in the phase shift. Okay, so this is a numerical approach to the resonance energy. But there is a simple case, which is the single pole approximation, and here you can perform all calculations analytically. And again, my example is carbon 12 plus proton. There is a resonance here, 0.42 MeV, that you can see in the elastic scattering data. So there is here a jump around 0.42. And so this is a good example to find a link between this E0 and ER. So in the single pole approximation, the R matrix only contains one term. And the general definition of the phase shift is here, which involves P, S, and the R matrix. So if you replace now the R matrix by the single pole approximation, it's very easy to see that we get this expression for the energy dependence. So this is the R matrix phase shift. And this is the standard Breit-Wigner phase shift with the resonance energy and with the width in the numerator. So what we would like to have is to make these two expressions equivalent. So this is the R matrix phase shift, this is the Breit-Wigner phase shift. So the question is how to make sure that they are equivalent. Well, then we know that the resonance energy is a solution of this equation where you have S, the function S, the shift function, and well, this shift function depends smoothly on energy. This was one of the questions for the exercise yesterday. You have seen by yourself this shift function weakly depends on energy. So here we can use the Thomas approximation, which means that we linearize the shift function around E0. So now if we replace this expansion here, it's a very simple calculation. So then you equal these two expressions, and you easily find that the resonance energy here is the pole energy and a shift. And this is the origin of the name of the shift function. So you can see here that you have this function S, and this is why it's called the shift function. So this term here is associated with the energy difference between the two. Okay, so this is here a simple calculation. So if you have E0, you can So if you have the air matrix parameters E0, gamma 0, then it's easy to compute ER. Okay? And the same thing for the width. So for the width, what you find is a correction, and the correction comes from this S prime. This is a derivative of the shift function. And this term here is called observed reduced width. Okay, so then you have an easy way for a single pole approximation to switch from one set of parameters to another one. And here I'd like to mention one important thing is that the resonance width is defined by the width at the resonance energy. And you see that this width depends on a constant, which is the observed width, and then you have a penetration factor. And we have seen that this penetration factor strongly varies with energy. When you have low energies, the penetration factor drops to very small values. This is true for reactions, but this is also true for resonances. So if you have a low energy resonance, this penetration factor will be small, and you should expect that the resonance will be very narrow. Okay, so this is a common property of all low energy resonance, that they are very narrow. And of course, these calculations here have been done with the single pole approximation. And if you want to go beyond and to introduce other terms here, of course, this simple calculation is not valid, and we have to move on to more general procedure. So this is a typical Breit-Wigner approximation. So you have here the Breit-Wigner approximation for a single pole. The phase shift varies from 0 to 180 degrees, and you have at the resonance energy pi divided by 2. So this is a standard Breit-Wigner approximation. So you can read the energy resonance from the place where it's pi over 2. And the width can also be read from this diagram. You just search where the phase shift path is through pi over 4, 3 pi over 4, and this energy difference is nothing but the width. And what we call a narrow resonance will be a resonance with a small gamma, so then there will be a fast jump, and this corresponds to long lifetimes. And a broad resonance, of course, is gamma large. Okay, and this it was for the cross section. Now, if you go back for the phase shift, sorry. So, if you go back to the cross section, I remind you that the elastic cross section is given by this expression, and if you take the Breit-Wigner approximation, then you easily get the resonant cross section around the resonance energy, and this has this well-known shape with a maximum at ER and half with a width at half maximum, which is gamma. So in fact, the peak is not symmetric because the width depends on the energy. There is a penetration factor. So my diagram here is oversimplified because the left part and the right part should be at least slightly different because the penetration factor is different. And of course, here you see there is a sum over all L's. So in general, you have one L with a resonance. So there is a background in the cross section coming from non-resonant partial waves. And in fact, we know also that the Breit-Wigner form is an approximation, so you may have some difference with respect to this Breit-Wigner. So this is a standard Breit-Wigner form, but in practice, it may be slightly different. So I just like to make a comment about the width of resonances. When do we say that the resonance is narrow or broad? Sometimes it's somewhat subjective. So a good way to decide whether a resonance is broad or narrow is to compare two characteristic times. One characteristic time is the resonance lifetime. So if you know the width, H bar over the width will provide you with the resonance lifetime. Okay, but the other characteristic time is the interaction time. So you know the energy of the resonance. So imagine that there is no resonance. The two particles will interact during a certain amount of time. And to estimate this amount of time, you can compute the distance where they interact divided by the velocity. And I take here two examples, C12 plus P. You know that the width is 32 keV. So if you convert that to lifetime, it's 2 × 10⁻². And now, if you want to compute the interaction time, you assume this is an order of magnitude. You can change that. It doesn't change the conclusion. You may assume that they interact during 10 Fermis, something like that. It can be slightly larger, slightly small. It doesn't matter. So you know the energy. So you know the velocity. And if you do that, you see that the interaction time is about 10⁻². So if you compare these two times, you see that the lifetime of the resonance is much larger than the interaction time. So the resonance makes this taste to live a long time. And this is seen in the phase shift. So you have here a narrow phase shift. So gamma is small, and you have this this behavior for the Breitwigner phase shift. And now let me consider another case, alpha plus proton. Here, well, the energy is 1.7, and here the width of this resonance is 1.2 MeV. If you look at tables, you will see that the ground state, this is in fact the lower state of lithium-5, has a width of 1.2. So again, you make the same calculations, and you find a lifetime of 6 × 10⁻². And again, if you compute the interaction time, it's about 5 × 10⁻². So here you have two numbers which are very similar to each other. And this is what we call a broad resonance. So the lifetime of the resonance is not significantly larger than the interaction time. And this is, if you look at experimental phase shift, you see that the phase shift is rather broad. So you have a structure like this. So this is important because sometimes in the literature you find results with a resonance which is 5 MeV broad. And then you may ask yourself the question, is it really a resonance or what? Okay, so this kind of comparison is important. Okay, so let me now come back to the link between the observed and calculated parameters. So I have shown in the previous transparencies these two formulas, which provides you the observed parameters in green here from the air matrix parameters. And you can invert these two equations, so you easily make a link between these two sets of parameters. But then when you have several poles, then the life is more complicated because this simple analytical calculation cannot be done anymore. So you have to solve this equation numerically. And this is a little more complicated. And this has been done in these two papers for single channel and multi-channel calculation. So Karl Brunn has generalized our method here, and this is what Ed was mentioning yesterday. And Karl Brunn proposed a method where you can start from the observed parameters, from the data, for example, and you can convert to the air matrix. So this is something very convenient because sometimes you know some data. You want to fit a cross-section. There are several resonances. Sometimes you don't know the width or the spin or some properties, but you know, for example, the energy. You know the width of another state. So you can constrain your parameters and then compute the air matrix parameters. And you will have this afternoon a tutorial on Azure with Ed, which will be an application of that. So here are two examples, C12 plus proton and C12 plus alpha. This C12 plus proton is a good example of a narrow resonance. So I've considered the air matrix phase shift for four different radii. And in this table, this is taken from experiment, resonance energy, total width, spin, and angular momentum. From this width, you can compute the observed reduced width, and E0 gamma 0 square. And you can see that this E0 and gamma 0 square strongly depends on the channel radius. And this is normal. This is as you expect. These numbers do not correspond to physical numbers. They are just air matrix parameters. So they strongly depend on the channel radius. So you see here, for example, you start from 0.42, which is the experimental energy, and the air matrix energy is minus 2.1. And now, if you plot the phase shift for these different conditions here, this is what you get. And of course, you can see that here there is a slight difference according to the channel radius. But you can see that this air matrix phase shift is rather constant. And again, this is what you expect from the air matrix. In spite of the fact that you have very different parameters here, the total air matrix is more or less constant. And you have here the hard sphere phase shift for the different channel radii. So this is for a narrow resonance. Now let me come to another case, which is C12 plus alpha. And here, well, the width is about 10 times larger, 420 kV. And here you compute, again, the same quantity for three channel radii. And again, you see that they depend on the channel radius. And this is the total phase shift. And, well, you see that at the resonance energy, which is 2.4, so here around 2.4, all calculations provide more or less the same phase shift. But when you are off resonance, then you have larger differences. And this is due to the fact that for broad resonances, you may have a background which is more important. And this is not included here. Okay, so the Breit-Wigner approximation is more and more valid for narrow resonances, where the background is supposed to be negligible. So this is a picture how to deal with a multi-resonance problem. So imagine that you have a situation like this. This would be the threshold. So your energies are somewhere here. In that case, you see there are two resonances in the energy range of interest. So you would consider these resonances individually. And here they are higher energy states, but because you are at energies much lower than this, you may gather them, merge them in a single term, which will be a background term. So in that case, the air matrix, the phenomenological air matrix, would contain one term associated with the first resonance, another with the other resonance, another one with the background. Okay, so this is the traditional way to proceed with the phenomenological air matrix. And then you can even neglect the background and replace this R0 by 0. So let me start with some applications to elastic scattering. So we know that the cross-section, the elastic cross-section is given here. We have seen that many times during this school. And what we need to compute this cross-section are the phase shift, delta L. So what we need, in fact, the delta L for all L values, not only for resonances, but for other, for all partial waves. So the strategy is to identify which resonances are important and to include them in the air matrix procedure. If there is one resonance which is important, then you will have one air matrix phase shift. But the other partial waves have to be included. And then there are two choices in the literature. Either you can assume that the non-resonance partial waves have a phase shift zero, or you may assume that they have R-sphere behavior. And this is consistent with the air matrix equal to zero. So in general, for non-resonant partial waves, if we assume that there is no resonance, so no air matrix, and you end up with the R-sphere phase shift. So this is a traditional way to proceed. In general, at least at low energies, there is no big difference between these two. But this is something you should keep in mind when you make air matrix fit. Okay, so this is my C12 plus proton favorite case. So I will show you the different fits. So here you have proton plus P elastic cross sections, and carbon is a stable beam. So these data are rather old, very precise, much more precise than current data with radioactive beams, of course. So you can make very accurate fits. So here we are interested in this energy region from 0 to 1 MeV. So if we apply my recipe from previous slides, we would introduce one resonance here, L equals 0. And for other partial waves, we use the R-sphere approximation. So here are the data sets at two different angles. And this is also a nice thing to have different angles because the air matrix parameters don't depend on the angle. So the same set of parameters should be able to reproduce different angles. So this is a strong way to constrain your parameters. So it's always better to have several angles. Of course, in some cases it's difficult, but here we have this kind of data. And you have here the air matrix results. So these are fit of these cross sections, 146 and 89 degrees. So a simultaneous fit of these two cross sections. And this is done for different channel radii, 4.5, 5, 5.5, and 6. And these two columns correspond to the observed properties, the experimental properties. So ER and gamma. And as you can see, these two columns slightly depend on the channel radius, but the dependence is very weak. So here it's about open. You have three significant digits, and here, well, two or maybe three. And these are the air matrix parameters, E0, gamma 0 square. And again, you find that they're strongly dependent on the channel radius. And if you plot the corresponding cross-section, you don't see any difference between these air matrix fits. So this is a nice situation because the data are very accurate. And tomorrow you will have the opportunity to make this kind of fits in a wider energy range by yourself. So another example, which is more recent and which uses a radioactive beam. So that was, in fact, there were two experiments at Louvain-la-Neuve with the Neon 18 beam. So there was a first experiment at low energies. So this is the spectrum of the unified nucleus, sodium 19. And well, we expected a resonance somewhere in this energy region, which was supposed to be the mirror state of this state in oxygen 19. So there was a first experiment in this energy range, and then a second experiment at higher energies, because here we were interested in mirror states of this state in oxygen 19. So this were the cross-sections, neon 18 plus P, which were measured at different angles. So again, you see 120, 156, 170 degrees as a function of the CM energy. And here again, we knew from theory that there was 1/2 plus resonance, which is L equals 0. So again, we used the same method. A single pole approximation for this resonance and a background for the rest. And then we found the properties of the resonance. 1.006 MeV and 100 keV for the proton width. And then, coming to the physics, what was interesting was to see that if you compare with oxygen 6, with oxygen 19, there is a strong Coulomb shift between these two states. So the Coulomb shift is the difference between both excitation energies. And this is consistent with the fact that this width here corresponds to a very large dimensionless reduced width. So if you compute the theta square is dimensionless, and very often we express it in percent, so it cannot be beyond 100%. Here is 23, and 23% is a large amount. So in most cases, about 1% or less than 1%. So it means that these states have a strong deformation and can be seen as a single particle state. With alpha particles, we would say cluster states, but in nucleon plus core, we are talking about single particle states. Okay, so these were two experiments, C12P, which was a test, which was done a long time ago, with stable beam, very intense. And this was a more recent experiment with radioactive beams. In fact, there are many data like this. This is a very good case for the air matrix because, as you see, the level density is very low. In this energy range, there is only one state. This is very different from other nuclei, which are close to the stability valley, and when you have many more levels. So the smaller the number of levels, the better for the air matrix. Okay, so let me now show you how to extend that to inelastic scattering and transfer. Of course, this is very similar. The calculations are a little more complicated. So I'm not going to develop everything, just to show you how to proceed. So here I assume that there are two channels. How to generalize the calculation for two channels. And then the pole, each pole, is now characterized by this energy, E0, as before, a reduced width in the entrance channel, as before, but now there is one additional parameter, and then I missed, I forgot to change here. It's the reduced width in the exit channel should be gamma F. So now instead of two parameters for each pole, we have three parameters, one associated with the exit channel. And then the air matrix, because we have two channels, is now 2x2 matrix. Because in the previous case, it was not a matrix. In fact, it was a number. So you have all, in each case, you have the same denominator, E0 minus E. And here you have gamma I square. This is associated with the entrance channel. The same with the exit channel. And the product gamma I, gamma F, which is associated with the transfer channel. Again, this assumes that there is a single pole. Okay, this may be oversimplified in some cases, but at least the calculations are simple. And the total width is the sum of the entrance and exit widths. And we can apply exactly the same procedure as before. So the total width is obtained from the reduced width in the entrance channel times the penetration factor. And the final width is the reduced width in the exit channel times the penetration factor. But the penetration factor should be computed relative to the exit channels. So this is the Q value, and this is the energy. So if the Q value is large, then the energy here, E plus Q, is large. And then you are in an energy range where the variation is low. If you are high energies, then the penetration factor is almost constant. So in general, the main energy dependence comes from this entrance channel penetration factor. So here, the strategy is exactly the same. From this 2x2 air matrix, you can compute a 2x2 scattering matrix. You can find the formulas in the in some papers which are in the website. And then from the scattering matrix, you can determine either elastic cross-sections from the diagonal part. This provides you with the elastic cross-sections. And the non-diagonal part provides you with the transfer cross-section. So these are simple extensions of the previous case. So this is a summary of the different situations that you may encounter. This is the simplest case. You have one threshold, one channel, so this is the black line here, and one resonance. So one channel, one pole, this is what I discussed in length in my talk today and yesterday, and then the air matrix is one by one as given by this single term. And then you may still have one channel, so one channel corresponding to this threshold here, and more than one resonances. So then you have a generalization of this. You still have a one by one matrix, but you have several poles. Okay? Then you may have several channels. So in general, it's two. You may consider more than two channels, but in practice, you only consider two. For example, for P alpha reactions, or alpha N, or PP prime, or whatever. So you have two thresholds, two channels, and one resonance. So the air matrix here is 2 by 2, IJ corresponds to the channel. And if you have a single resonance, then there is a single term here. And here you can perform some analytical calculation. And of course, the most complicated case is when you have several channels and several poles. So here the air matrix is a it's truly a matrix, it's not a one-by-one function, and you have here a sum over the poles. So this is the most complicated case, and one application is, for example, fluorine 18 P alpha, that I think Ed mentioned yesterday. It's a very complicated case because you have two channels, because it's P alpha, and you have many resonances which interfere with each other, so you have problems with the sign here, so this is a very complicated case. So you can see that you have some hierarchy. You start from very simple calculation and then you generalize to more and more complicated case. So this is an example of transfer reactions. This is helium 3 plus helium 3 DP, which is important in nuclear astrophysics. So you have here the spectrum of lithium 5, alpha plus P threshold is here, helium 3 plus D threshold is there, 18 MeV for the Q value. So all energies which are shown here correspond to the energies referred to this threshold there. And as you can see, there is a resonance here, 3.5 plus. And if you look at the spins, this corresponds to a L equals zero resonance. And you can see this resonance here in the S factor. So this is the S factor as a function of energy. And these are very low energies. What you would like to know is the S factor in this astrophysical energy there. And this is a typical case of Breit-Wigner two-channel calculations. So the cross-section at the Breit-Wigner approximation is given here. You have the entrance channel corresponding to the deuteron width, the final channel corresponding to the alpha or proton width. So the this gamma I is given by the standard expression. The final states, you have the penetration factor, but as I said, because Q is 18 MeV, this is almost constant. And from this data, you can read the width by taking the width of this peak at half maximum. It provides you with the total width. And the amplitude is proportional to the product divided by gamma square. So here, if you choose E equal ER, this term here is zero. So you are left with the product divided by gamma square. So with these two parameters, you can find the two widths. So you have two unknown widths, two quantities here, and you can derive these suites. And at low energies, so the cross section, the energy dependence is given by 1 over E. So this k square is proportional to the energy and is proportional to the width in the entrance channel, because the width in the exit channel is almost constant. So this is proportional to 1 over E times the penetration factor. And now if you switch to the S factor, not the astrophysical S factor, I told you there are many S in this business. This is not the shift function, this is the astrophysical S factor, which has nothing to do with the shift function. So if you convert this if you convert this cross section in S factor, you remove the E and you multiply by exponential 2 pi eta. So you compensate this penetration factor and you find something which is almost constant. And this is what you can see here. And you can see here there are different fits of the data which only differ by the channel radius. So there is a slight sensitivity here corresponding to the channel radius, because you are far off resonance, so there is some sensitivity, but it's a few percent only. So this is a nice case for single resonance approximation. So another another application to multi-channel calculation is the neon 18 plus P inelastic scattering. I told you a few minutes ago there was a first experiment to look at elastic scattering, and then there was a second experiment 5 years ago at Louvain-la-Neuve to measure the inelastic scattering, neon 18 PP prime. And so then you have here three angles. And on the upper figures, you have the inelastic and here the elastic cross sections at the same angles. And well, a nice thing about the inelastic scattering is that there is no Coulomb. And we know that the Coulomb term may be large, and then you don't see the interesting effects, because Coulomb is larger than the nuclear part. And you can see here in the elastic cross section, you hardly see this variation. And in the inelastic scattering, you clearly see the peaks which are here much better. And this is just because there is no Coulomb interferences. So here, there were two resonances. So we used a multi-channel air matrix. So there are two states, two peaks here. And because we are dealing with inelastic scattering, there are three parameters: the energy of the resonance, the elastic width, and the inelastic width. So it makes fits with six parameters, because there are two states. And then we could end up with the properties of these two resonances. And one of the conclusions is that if you look here, you see that the reduced width in the excited channel is much larger than the reduced width in the elastic channel. So this theta squared 2 refers to the inelastic channel. So here you have a very interesting case. You have two states here, which corresponds to a structure with the core is excited. So these are neon 19 states with a neon 18 core, but in an excited state. So the excited state contribution is much more important than the elastic channel. Okay. So with this data, we could have rather complete overview of neon 18 plus P. So these are elastic scattering data coming from different experiments. So there were here three experiments, so we combined everything. So this low energy resonance came from the first experiment, and this is clearly observed in the elastic scattering with a strong reduced width in the elastic channel. This is called a single particle state. And here you have these famous two states, which are difficult to observe in the elastic cross section, as I mentioned before. But much easier to observe in the inelastic channel, and they are referred to single particle states with an excited core. So this is the kind of physics that you can make with this air matrix fit. And here is a very recent application with fluorine 18 pp and fluorine 18 p alpha. So fluorine 18 p alpha is very important in astrophysics, but also very difficult. There is a theorem saying that when a reaction is important, it's also difficult. So there are many resonances, so many parameters. So you see here there were 8 resonances, so 24 parameters. And here the idea was to measure P alpha and PP simultaneously. And this is something important because even if PP is not important for astrophysics, you don't care about PP for astrophysics, but it contains the same air matrix parameters, the same resonance energies, and the same proton widths. So you have with this PP data here, very strong constraint on the air matrix fit. And this is a general statement. If you measure an inelastic or transfer cross-section and you want to fit them by the air matrix, it's important to have elastic scattering data. Even if it's not the process that you are interested in, it provides you with additional constraint on the air matrix parameters. And then I'd like to finish with mentioning the extension to radiative capture. In my lecture of Friday, I talk about radiative capture, and I showed you the application to the potential model. But in fact, the air matrix can also be applied to the radiative capture. And I remind you that the radiative capture is an electromagnetic process. So it's a transition between an initial scattering state, I here, to a final bound state there. And a cross-section, as a general definition, is given by this kind of matrix element of the electromagnetic interaction, the final state here and the initial state there. And here, to deal with capture cross-sections, you have to introduce one additional parameter for the pole. And this additional parameter is the gamma width, because you want to treat an electromagnetic process. So you have to include the gamma width of the pole. And you know, in the air matrix, the principle of the air matrix is to split the matrix element, so this matrix element here, in an internal and an external part. This is a general idea of the air matrix. And, well, I don't want to enter into detail, but just to show you the main results. The internal matrix element is again given by a sum where you have these energies here as before. You have the reduced widths in the elastic channels as before. But now we have something which is associated with the gamma widths of the poles. So these are the gamma widths of these poles, and this provides you with the internal part of the matrix element. And in the external region, we can use the asymptotic behavior of the wave functions, and we know that a scattering state is provided by a combination of incoming and outgoing Coulomb functions. And you have the scattering matrix here. And the scattering matrix is provided, as usual, by the air matrix. You have the electromagnetic operator R to the power lambda here. And you have the Whittaker functions, which correspond to the bound states, which are here. And this C is the asymptotic normalization constant. So this is one additional parameter that you have to consider. So you have here some parameters in the internal part, one parameter in the external part, and then you can determine the capture cross-section. Of course, it's a little bit more complicated than elastic scattering. And one of the difficulties that is this external part. And well, in some cases, like C12 alpha gamma, when you have a deeply bound state, this Kf is large, so this W drops to very small values, and you can neglect this external part. So in some cases, when you can neglect it, the calculations are easier because you are left with this this expression. But well, there are many applications in nuclear astrophysics. This C12 alpha gamma, helium-3 alpha gamma. Well, there are many interesting cases. Okay, so you can find development in several papers or textbooks. Okay, so let me come to my general conclusion about the Air matrix. I insisted on that at the beginning, but it's important to remind you that there is one Air matrix per partial wave. So you may consider Air matrix for 100 or 1,000 partial waves if you like, but in practice it's not realistic. So this is applied in case where there is a few partial waves, so it means in practice low energies. So practical applications of the Air matrix are limited to low energies. And then with the Air matrix, you are not limited to resonances. You can describe resonant and non-resonant contributions as well. And one important thing, and sometimes it's ignored by people, is that there are two variants, the calculable Air matrix to solve the Schrödinger equation and the phenomenological Air matrix to fit data. And many people believe that these are two different methods. And in fact, it's the same method, which is just applied in two different ways. But the origin is completely common. So for the calculable Air matrix, the main goal is to solve scattering states for the Schrödinger equation. And in fact, it's essentially started with atomic physics. There are many developments, theoretical developments, which have been done in atomic physics. And in parallel in nuclear physics, it's amazing to have a look at the literature, and both fields have developed almost the same methods, with different units and ignoring each other. So we can learn many things about the Air matrix in atomic physics. Well, I think this is a very efficient method to determine phase shift for, in particular for multi-channel calculations, as I've shown yesterday with the CDCC. And in that case, of course, you have to test the stability of the result with respect to the radius. This radius is not a parameter. At the end, the result should not depend, and I think this is what you have seen yesterday with the tutorial in a simple calculation. And the phenomenological Air matrix starts from the same ID, but here the pole properties are used as free parameters, and of course you want this number of parameters to be as small as possible. So the most standard applications are with a single resonance, but you can extend to many resonances if you wish. And I'd like to say that there are many applications. I've just shown you a few of them, essentially to elastic scattering because it's easier, but you can easily extend that to transfer, to capture. The applications to beta decay, and in fact, as soon as you have continuum states, then the Air matrix is something very efficient, and I recommend you to use it if you are dealing with low energy reactions. Okay, I think I'm a little ahead of my schedule, but we can have coffee, or I can answer questions if you have. Sorry? Okay.
can I remind people, please, that they have to discuss with projects